Welcome to Baraton TV, here and hereafter. We are glad you're joining us again for the Bible Quarterly Lesson Study. This is wonderful because we are on this exciting study of present truth in Deuteronomy. Mm-hmm. And yes, the year is winding down. We are on the lesson that finishes up this year, the final quarter of 2021. This has gone pretty fast. I don't know about you, but it feels like someone is pulling time. I don't know where it's taking us, but all we know, Christ is coming back.
Amen.
As we study the book of Deuteronomy. And our theme today is indeed sweet. To love the Lord your God.
Amen.
To love the Lord your God. And I know many people, including myself, when we see the word love, we get excited. And here we are not talking about it in any other context, but in the context of God, the author of love. Him who is love. Before we go further, I'm going to request that we have a word of prayer. At this point, I'm going to request Pastor Hobson kindly pray for us.
Well, thank you. Mm-hmm. Shall we pray? Our loving Father, who art in heaven, we thank you for this opportunity that we may study your word. Oh, we humbly pray for the Holy Spirit that he may open our eyes, that we may see wondrous things from your word. This we pray, trusting and believing in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Wonderful. To love the Lord, your God. This is a great study. It doesn't get more practical than I found it, because the lesson writer puts it in a way that I had not thought about, that the book of Deuteronomy, more than anything, is a book about love.
Amen.
Now, of all books, I didn't think Deuteronomy is about love. But when you see the lesson we are studying, and when you take time to go through this book, you will be convinced to come to the same conclusion like the writer of the lesson. Why don't we go to chapter 6, verse 5 of the book of Deuteronomy, so that we may reflect on the key verse, which of many verses we come across, this one we can put it in our memories. Deuteronomy 6, 5. What does the Bible say? The Bible says, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your what?
Your strength.
With all your strength." Now, we want to dive deeper into that text, because my prayer is that by the end of this, you and me will be in a position to devote ourselves to God fully. But I don't know about you, but this text calls us to action. It doesn't leave us seated where we are. It doesn't. It unsettles us and puts us in a position to view God differently and how we relate to him. You see, the writer tells us about the Jews that when they would be praying, the line that we find in verse 5, sorry, in verse 4, which says, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord, is one." We learn that this forms part of their prayer, which is called the Shema, right?
Mm-hmm.
That they pray this line, this prayer, you know, it's part of a prayer they do, when their eyes are closed, but with an aim of not having any distraction between them and God, to have unfettered access to God without anything coming in between them. And as I was thinking about that, how many times do we pray, or how many times do we attempt to study the word of God, to have time with him, but you know, my mind is all over the place. So what I pick from this practice, and we don't know how far they go in this, because it's an individual decision, and it's a commitment that we make to our God. As we reflect on this verse, that our God indeed is one, therefore, you know, we need to love him with all our heart, with all our soul, and with all our strength. we give him undivided attention, mm-hmm. knowing that indeed he's the only God. Mm-hmm. He's not a backup. It's just to sum up the thing, he's the only God. Therefore, love him with your all. Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 1 and 2, as we continue to focus on this theme, Deuteronomy 6, 1 and 2. If you want to read, kindly go ahead, Pastor, so that we may continue on.
Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 1 and 2. Mm-hmm. Now this is the commandment, mm-hmm. and these are the statutes and judgments which the Lord your God has commanded to teach you, that you may observe them in the land which you are crossing over to possess, that you may fear the Lord your God, to keep all his statutes and his commandments, which I command you, and your sons and your grandson, all the days of your life, and that your days may be prolonged.
Moses is giving out a speech, telling the children of Israel what is expected of them in relation to their God. It begins with a commandment, the statutes and judgments which the Lord wants the children of Israel not to forget. And like you get to appreciate in this book of Deuteronomy, I would fast forward and tell you that he was putting all these for the prosperity of Israel, for their welfare, for their goodness. We see Moses telling them what they needed to do, not in their power, but in the power of God. Mm-hmm. Out of his grace, he was to enable them to be able to keep his commandment and his statutes for their good. In fact, you encounter a verse in this great book that says that out of their obedience, the nations will be able to admire them, mm-hmm. and say, who are these? God graciously does this to fulfill the promise he had given their fathers, to move them from captivity into the promised land. Now he says, now as we move, as we look yonder to the land I promised you, keep my commandment, my statutes, my judgments, and this will be your expression of love unto me as I do love you. Because we see that this love originates from God unto these people. You get to appreciate that. So, what is the meaning then of this command that we find here? What is the meaning? Because in verse 5, we have seen it written that we shall love the Lord our God with all our heart, with all our soul, and with all our strength. What I see this calling me to, I don't know about you, is total surrender. Mm-hmm. You see, I'm reminded of the song we sing, All to Jesus, I Surrender. And many times when I'm singing it and I'm conscious, I get pricked. I'm like, do you actually mean what you're singing, Joel? Mm-hmm. Because all to him I freely give, the song goes on to say, and I wonder, wait a minute, have I actually given all freely unto him? So that if you're thinking through those lyrics, you're pushed to want to stop singing because you're like, have I actually surrendered fully to God? God is calling us here unto total surrender. Mm-hmm. And this we can't do by ourselves. We do this by his power, by his strength. The lesson writer puts it that loving God with all our heart, soul, and strength means that our love for him should be supreme over our love of everything and everyone else. Mm-hmm. Wherever they are, those people are right under. God is above. We place him where he needs to be, at a pedestal where none of our properties and accumulations, and yes, our earthly friends, are not. That God reigns supreme over them. Why? Because he's the foundation and ground of all our being. Because we've already acknowledged that our God is one, that we have only one God. as we do that, as we love him and put our love for him supreme, everything else comes right in the context where it's supposed to be. And the cause of all our problems is not placing God where he's supposed to be in our individual lives. And at a corporate level, the world not acknowledging God for where he's supposed to be. My prayer then is that we may take time to ask ourselves, what does it mean to you and to me to love God with our all? What does it mean? With our soul, strength, and might, what does it mean? So that the answer to that may be what we give unto our God. More can be said. I point you to continue to listen to what is being shared here. Pastor Hobson,
yes.
Take us on.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, Elder, for the explanation on how we should love God,
mm-hmm.
because it's our duty to love God. We shall be diving deeper
mm-hmm.
on how to love God
mm-hmm.
and what is the Bible's injunctions and commands, or rather instructions,
mm-hmm.
on our duty in loving God back. Or rather, how can we get this love? Because we know God is love,
mm.
and he who does not love does not know God.
Mm.
But he who loves knows God.
Mm.
So it means there is a connection between love, between true love, and the God whom we serve, who is in heaven. But then, in the very same passage, we find the phrase "fear God."
Mm.
You know, the Israelites are told, you know, you should love God.
Yes.
But also remember to fear him.
Mm.
So. How do these two phrases appear in the same passage?
Mm.
You know, how can you fear the Lord? Because, well, we've been told to love him, but then again, you are told to fear him.
Mm.
Now, what is the meaning of this fear God? Because if we fear God, then our love for him will not be voluntary.
Mm.
It will be somehow forced.
Mm.
It will be a responsibility to love
him. Mm. We must
love him. Now, in the Bible, this is not the only place where we find love God, or rather fear God. In Revelation chapter 14, verse 6, verse 7, it says, the angel of the first message, it says, fear God and give glory to him.
Mm.
That is the message of the first angel. And in Proverbs, in Proverbs chapter 8, verse 13, it says, to fear the Lord is to hate evil.
Mm.
Now, taking these two verses into consideration, to fear the Lord is to hate evil, then having the fear of the Lord, or rather to fear the Lord, is to hate evil. Now, naturally, we do not hate evil. Naturally, we prefer to sin.
Mm.
We are inclined to sin. Then it means the fear of the Lord, who implants the fear of the Lord in us, it is the Lord himself.
Mm.
It is the Lord himself that gives us his fear.
Amen.
So it means his fear is respect unto him. It is reverence unto him, to revere him. So, dear friends, the fear, teachers who are harsh, rather this could be in a primary setting or a high school setting, whereby the teacher could be very harsh. And then the students could be fearing the teacher.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it is because the teacher is harsh.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this is not the relationship that should exist between Christians and God. Because indeed, the word fear God, as it is appearing in the Bible, it is there to remind us that this is a responsibility. As much as we have a part to play, God is coming to help us. He's coming to instill this fear in us,
mm-hmm.
that we may revere him, that we may love him. Now then, there is a connection between fearing God and loving him. This is the connection.
Mm-hmm.
So if fearing God is hating evil,
mm-hmm.
and we cannot hate evil by ourselves, so mm-hmm. it means the Holy Spirit must be in us so that we may hate evil,
mm-hmm.
we may hate lying, we may hate coveting.
Mm-hmm.
Then the opposite of hating evil is loving righteousness.
Mm.
Now, if I hate evil, I love righteousness.
Mm.
Then this means, if righteousness is in me, And righteousness is inseparable with God, God himself, because God is righteous. Then it means God is in me. Now, friends, this is the simple method of getting to fear God. This is how we get to fear God. It is by receiving God in our hearts. Now, when we shall receive God in our hearts, of course, he will teach our hands. He will teach our feet on how to walk. Of course, his word is a light unto our feet and a lamp unto our path. This means that it will teach us how to fear God. Now, that is why in Revelation we read that, you know, fear God and give glory to him. Or the angel is saying, you should allow God into you. You should allow the Holy Spirit to work in your heart, so that when the Holy Spirit has worked in your heart, you will learn to keep the commandments. Because in keeping the commandments, it means you hate evil. Yeah, that is what also Moses is reminding the Israelites. I believe that is what God would want us to have today. God would want us to fear him, which means to live to do what is right. I would also love to talk about his love. You see, for a parent to a child, when a child comes into when a child is born, let me use that. When a child is born, of course, this child does not really know much about love. This child gets to love by and by, of course, as it advances in age. But then the parent, he has this fondness for it, for his child. He loves his child. Now, this relationship with God, we can find this in Jeremiah chapter, that perhaps you can read this. Elder, you can help us read this, please. Jeremiah chapter 31, verse 3. What is the love relationship? Should we love God because, you know, does he anyway care? Does he love us? Should we love him so that he can love us back? Please.
31:3, Jeremiah. 3,
yes, please.
Jeremiah 31:3.
Yes.
The Lord has appeared of old to me, saying,
yes,
yes, I have loved you with an everlasting love. Therefore, with loving kindness, I have drawn thee.
Oh, amen. So this is God saying, you know, I have loved you with an everlasting love. And therefore, with loving kindness, have I drawn you. You know, it is also in Romans that we read that it is the goodness of God that leads us to repentance. Now, God is ever yearning to be close to us. God is ever yearning to be close to us. The reason why he's yearning to be close to us, it is because he loves us. You know, you won't be bothered to be close to a person whom you don't care for. Anyway, you won't be bothered to so much follow a person whom you know you don't love. You'll follow a person whom you love. And that is the reason why God is following us. That is the reason why day in, day out, he's providing for us. It is because he loves us. Now, love begets love. You know, if you love a person, this person, of course, it's like you are opening a door so that this person may come in. So love begets love. And this is the only way that we can get to love God. This is the only way. As Christ said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. This is the only way that you get to love God, because he has first loved us. No one should ever force us to love God, but it is because he has first loved us. Now, dear friend, it is true that God loves us today. Oh, this is evident. Acts 17:28 says, in him we live and move and have our being.
Amen.
You know, we are not working as watches. It means that every moment of life that we enjoy, we are drawing this from him. Literally. We are attached. This life energy that gets us moving, gets us living, it is right from him. So then this means, how much he loves us, that, you know, he sustains us, he's providing for us. This is love, everlasting love, amazing love. Now, the reason why, again, I should emphasize, the reason why God is revealing this unto us, it is because he would want us to love him back. Now, we should love him because he first loved us. Yes, dear friend. This is his message unto us, that I have loved you with an everlasting love, and therefore with loving kindness do I draw you unto me. Thank you, Elder.
Wow, beautiful it is.
Oh, thank you.
It is wonderful, beautiful. Wonderful. Pastor Smile, kindly take us on.
Yeah, we we want to look at this aspect of love and obedience. Israel as a nation had been told to love the Lord their God with all their heart, with all their soul, with all their might. In as much as they were supposed to love God as a whole nation, they also had to love God individually. The way we are seated here, I'm sure God wants us all to love Him, but we are all called to love Him individually. And this choice to love God is also is revealed in our obedience to God. This is very elaborate when we read through the book of Deuteronomy. For example, Deuteronomy chapter 5, verse 10, the Bible tells us to love God and keep His commandments. In Deuteronomy chapter 7 and verse 9, who love Him and keep His commandments. I'm just paraphrasing. In Deuteronomy chapter 10, verse 12 and 13, the Bible tells us to love God and to serve Him. In Deuteronomy chapter 11 and verse 1, love the Lord, keep His judge, keep His statutes, keep His judgments, keep His commandments. In Deuteronomy chapter 19, verse 9, love the Lord and walk in His way. And so we see that the book of Deuteronomy is very clear that loving God is linked, is very much closely linked to obeying God. Just as surely as God does not have to merely say, I love you. We've already seen in the book of Jeremiah 31, God has told us, oh, I have loved you with everlasting love. See, with loving kindness have I drawn you to me. God does not just tell us He loves us, but He goes an extra mile. He takes a further steps and He shows His love for us by actions, by creating us, by sustaining us. And the best of acts to show the love of God for us was definitely at the cross of Calvary.
Oh, yes.
So we who love God because He first loved us, therefore, we don't have to stand everywhere and shout, hey, I love God. You know, Christians today love professing Christianity. Say, hey, I'm Christian. I love Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of my life. I was baptized in this year. I met Him in this year. We've been walking. We don't have to shout in every city that we love God. But even through our actions, even through our conduct, it can be seen that truly we love God. And this is why John the beloved disciple says in 1 John chapter 5 verse 3, for this is the love of God, that we keep His commandments. Amen. Even Jesus Christ himself says in the book of John chapter 14 verse 15, if you love me, keep my commandment.
Oh, yes.
So love to God must always be expressed by obedience to God. The commandments that the Bible is talking about is definitely the Ten Commandments. And how many of the commandments are we supposed to keep? Ten of the commandments, including the fourth commandment. This is simply a response of love. We keep them simply because we love God. We don't so much keep them as to be saved, but we keep them because we are saved. Already saved. Some people ask, isn't obeying God legalistic? Isn't obeying God legalism? There are some people who obey God in a legalistic approach, in a legal way. They think they will earn their way to heaven. Obeying God in a legalistic way definitely does not really come out of love. But true love for God without legalism, it will be revealed in acts of obedience to the law of God. We see Moses over and over again in the book of Deuteronomy reminding the children of Israel to love the Lord their God. And he reminds them, remember, you are slaves in the land of Egypt. Remember what the Lord has done for you. The Lord had just brought them out of Egypt with a mighty hand. And so today, when we remember the things that the Lord has done for us, when we remember the goodness of God in your life and in my life, when we remember just how God has loved us, the response from our end will be to love God, which will be seen in our obeying of His commandments. You see, in the Christian world today, many people try to separate the Old from the New Testament. Many people try to say there's a different God in the Old Testament, a different God in the New Testament. Some people say, I'm a New Testament Christian, I'm an Old Testament Christian. You see, friends, the Bible tells us in 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 16 that all scripture is given by inspiration of God. All scripture is God-breathed. When Paul was writing these words, the only scripture that was available was the Old Testament. There's a time a young man came to Jesus and asked him, what shall I do to enter eternal life? And Jesus Christ asked him, what is your reading of the law? How have you read the scriptures? What is your understanding of it? Definitely, Jesus Christ was referring him back to the Old Testament. We see Jesus Christ himself quoting in his sermons, in his speeches, severally, he quotes back to the Old Testament. In Luke chapter 4, verse 16 to 18, we will see Jesus Christ saying some words from the book of Isaiah. And so, in the book of Mark chapter 12, Mark chapter 12, verse 28 to 30. Mark chapter 12, verse 28 to 30. There's a scribe who asked Jesus a very important question. Then one of the scribes came, and having heard them reasoning together, perceiving that he had answered them well, asked him, which is the first commandment of all? Jesus answered him, the first of all the commandments is, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one, and you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. This is the first commandment. It's very interesting. It makes me so happy. We are studying the book of Deuteronomy. We are studying present truth in the book of Deuteronomy. And when Jesus Christ was asked, hey, you teacher of the law, what is the first commandment? Oh, he took the guy back to Deuteronomy chapter 6 and verse 4, which starts with, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. Jesus Christ was teaching us to have supreme love for God. And definitely later he will go on to quote that the second is like the first. We should love our neighbor as we love ourselves. This is revealed in impartial love for man. Supreme love for God, impartial love for man. What could be more present truth than this command? Even in these very last days, the Bible is still echoing to us, hear, O Israel, hear, O spiritual Israel, hear, O you who love the Lord our God is one, and we shall love him with all our heart, all our soul, and all our might. We also see in the book of Revelation chapter 14 verse 12 that the commandments plays a very crucial role for the end time children of God. And so we see that ultimately there is a side we have to choose. Even in the face of persecution, it will be based on whether we truly love God or whether we don't love him. And that's the deciding issue. And we can come to love God with all our heart and soul and might only as we come to know him for ourselves and experience for ourselves his goodness. It is not only enough to hear Mr. Hobson saying, oh, God is good, God is love. I have to experience the goodness of God in my life so that I myself may testify and say, surely God is love. I must witness the goodness of God, the love of God, the grace of God in my life. And that is the only time that I can love God with all my heart. Thank you, Wilda.
Wow. What a study we have had. And I pray you'll continue having, because this cannot just end here. To love the Lord your God. This is personal. This is for you. This is for me. Joel, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. That is my prayer for you. That is my prayer for myself, that we may reflect on these words of God. To the children of Israel, whom, like we have appreciated, they were right at the borders of the promised land, Canaan. And you and me know we are right on the borders of heaven, our Canaan that we are awaiting. May God bless you as you continue to study the word. The lesson is provided for you to download in the description. The lesson points us to the Bible, the words of life that point us to God. We are going to have a word of prayer that ends this. Let us pray. Father in heaven, we want to thank you for your word. We pray that your spirit may dwell in us to be able to respond to the love that you have given us. Yes, your love that is unfathomable, that we may love you with all our hearts, with all our soul, and with all our might. Thank you for hearing and answering our prayer. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Amen.